really are. Okay. Okay. Verse 23. For they also, if they abide not still in unbelief, in other words, if they ever come to believe it, they should be what? Grafted in. For God is able to do it. For if thou were cut out of the olive tree, which is wild by nature, and you were grafted contrary to nature into a good tree, how much more should these, which be the natural branches, be grafted into their own olive tree? He can put the natural branch back in. But he's broken it off because of unbelief. And this definitely tells us that in Scripture, the Jewish people brought Jesus Christ to Pontius Pilate and said, kill him, crucify him. We're going up on him. And Pontius Pilate said, I haven't found nothing wrong with the man. What do you want me to kill him for? They said, if you don't kill him, you're not a friend of Rome. So he says, guess what, buddy? You got to go. He wanted to wash. He said, I wash my hands of this. This is an innocent man. And I find no fault in him. I'm going to kill him. Yes, sir.
I came out of a Baptist church, and I wondered something about that 23. Is that having to do with kind of a once saved, always saved?
Yeah, so see, as soon as unbelief kick in, no matter who you are, mm-hmm. you're pretty much out. Right.
But if you,
I thought he loved me. he loved it. He loved him too.
But if you
repent, go back to what you're supposed to be, you're in. So if you existed in unbelief. Unbelief is demonstrated through action. Ooh, some kind of call it obedience. Disobedience. Disobedience is demonstrated through what? Action. Obedience is demonstrated proven through action as well. No argument about it.
So you've heard the thing in the Baptist church said about once saved, always saved.
Once saved, always saved. Okay, Israel, once in, always in? No. Once in, broken off. Same thing can happen to you. Because of, not that he don't love you, but because of unbelief. Unbelief and God don't match. Don't work. Can't get nothing. He can't do nothing with unbelief. Oh. So Israel now, and the Jewish people, Hebrew people, they have their mindset that we know who the Messiah is. We know they're right. We are God's chosen people. They got that. God loves us. He'll do whatever he needs to do for us. Yeah, you're right. But look at what you're going through because of your unbelief. You've been scattered from little tiny Israel to all the nations of the earth. You got to go run for safety. And look how they treat you as foreign people in any land that you go to. They have ever been to persecuted. Oh, don't land in Germany. Oh, good, they did. Whoa, how many are you going to throw and cook in the ovens?
Too many.
Million, 6 million. Put them in the oven. Oh, there's some twins. Let's experiment on them. Do some stupid stuff like that. Oh, man. Sterilize water, don't sterilize the oven. Some crazy stuff. Just people just do it. Don't even see them as human beings. It's a small population on the earth of that race of people who are God's chosen people, but through unbelief, they're going through some stuff. Now, it's going to have, we mentioned last week, Armageddon's going to have to kick in for them to call on the Lord to save them, and guess what's going to happen? The Lord is going to save them, but they got to go through all of that to get saved. Look at Romans 10, chapter 10, verse 1. We haven't used that too big, but that's fine. Okay. Romans chapter 10, verse 1. Paul being a Hebrew. Got something to say. What did he say there? Verse 10, chapter 10, verse 1 and 2.
Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. Mm. For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge.
All right, they have a zeal. They think they know. Yeah, they got the first five books of the Bible. They're trying to work in that. They know about the tabernacle in the wilderness. They know all of that stuff. They know about David and David. And they know about Daniel and the lions. They know all of that. But when it comes to obtaining salvation through faith in Jesus Christ, they don't know. They have went about to establish their own righteousness. And that's what he says. They're going to get in trouble. So my heart's desire. Many, and a couple other times in the New Testament, Paul wrote concerning his kinsmen. I wish all black people could come on and get saved. I mean, like to see all black people get saved. Because what? Because you're your kin folks. Somehow or another, y'all linked in together, kin folks. So Paul says, my desire is that all my kin folks would accept Jesus. But he said, my desire, but he says, it won't happen because they got this head thing around. No heart. Okay. So they get in trouble. And that's how Israel got in trouble from the day of Moses on forward. That's how they got in trouble. What we talked about last week, Moses says, I'm going up to the top of the mountain, get the Ten Commandments, y'all stay here and pray. I'll be right back. Aaron, be in charge so I get back. It's up there 40 days, praying fast. You get back down the hill, coming down the mountain, you hear this noise. What is that noise? They're pointing at you. Created a false god, put it right in the middle of the camp. Orgies all over the place. Moses. This is the people that I left. What? He got the Ten Commandments written on stone. He gets so mad, he throws it down. Moses is mad. God said, Moses, I didn't tell you to get mad. Moses, look at your people. Look at them. God said, yeah, I see them. I'm mad too. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm just going to kill them all. Moses says, I'll go back up. Stuff happens all the time. God's ready to kill them all the time. Tell them to have faith in me. I'm going to deliver them from Egypt. Tell them to have faith. They don't believe nothing. God says, I'm going to kill them. The only reason why Israel is here today is because of one man praying. His name was Moses. God, don't kill them. If you kill them, the heathen, the Gentiles, will say that you're not able to deliver. Don't kill them. I'll tell you what I'm going to do, Moses. God says, they're yours. They're all yours, Moses. They ain't mine. No, God, I don't want them either. So they stay in trouble. That's their life. In, up and down with God. In and out with God. Misery, comfort. That's their life with God until the millennium reign kicks in. But there's somebody in the way. Who is that? Us. Called the church. God says, since Israel don't want it, I'm giving it to the Gentiles. The Gentiles have it now. We're running with it. We call it the church. Church, not a brick and mortar, not so much brick and mortar, but as much of an assembly of believers called the church. And in the earth, the church is stopping a lot of bad stuff from happening. It's called the church. That's what he says there, Romans 11 and 25, until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. Until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. Okay. All right.
The church is supposed to promote Israel to jealousy.
The church is supposed to make Israel, the Hebrew people, jealous. And they do get kind of jealous. They get kind of ticked off of us claiming the things that are supposed to be theirs.
When is the cutoff time for the Gentiles?
When is the time? When is the cutoff time? We don't know. We don't know. Well, I mean, we know that as things develop, unfold, a little bit at a time, it looks like the end is coming pretty quick, pretty soon. I can't put it on the calendar. I can't cross the X's, and that's it right there. The clock, that's the time. You got some fools in it. Why? Okay.
Well, it says in 25 until the full number of Gentiles has come in.
Uh-huh.
So I guess I don't know what that means.
Until the fullness of them have come in, to all of them, until the word has reached every Gentile. He has had opportunity to get saved. when that opportunity is expired, or when everyone has already said yay or nay, by how? Their actions. He says, okay, I've covered. The gospel's been preached, been presented to everybody. All the Gentiles have heard. And the clock stops ticking. Time's up. And that's Revelation. We're into the book of Revelation now, all of a sudden. Okay. So let's see what my lesson's going to tell us today. We're dealing with some bad preachers, bad pastors, shysters. God's fed up with them. Over there in Ezekiel, the 34th chapter. Whoa, way back there. Ezekiel, just before Daniel. My Bible's in order. Just to recap right quick, I think we're going to be moving fast enough to just do a real fast recap. It's 10 o'clock. Ezekiel 34, verse 1. We're going to pick out some verses in there. First of all, the 34th chapter, verse 1. And the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, prophesy against the shepherds of Israel. Prophesy, say to them, Thus said the Lord God unto the shepherds. Who are the shepherds? Shepherds are what? Pastors. Woe to the pastors, I woe to the shepherds of Israel that do feed who? Themselves instead of my people. Okay? If they feed themselves, they're taking advantage of the people. We're supposed to feed the people the word of God. We're taking up the collection money. All the money that Curtis bring in, I'm going down applying it toward my Lexus. Alright, gonna keep moving. Verse 7. Therefore, ye shepherds, hear the word of the Lord. As I live, said the Lord God, surely because my flock became a prey, and my flock became meat to every beast of the field, because there was what? No shepherd. Everybody fell into some kind of sin because there was no good pastor. Neither did my shepherd search, didn't even go after him when he saw him in sin, saw him in trouble, didn't even go after to help him. Oh, boy. But the shepherds did what? Fed themselves. Went out and bought a cat like this week. Traded Lexus in. Okay. All right. And that's what's going on. Now we're going to go down to our lesson, verse 23 of our lesson. So God says, I ran through all these shepherds and they, that they're not no good. This is for your information, Ezekiel 34th verse, verse 7 through 10. It's talking about how God's going to put judgment on them. And now, God saying, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to take responsibility. Here's what I'm going to do. Verse 23. Can you read that, Sister Cam? Ezekiel 34 and 23.
And I will set up one shepherd over them, and he shall feed them, even my servant David. He shall feed them. And he shall be their shepherd.
He shall be their shepherd. He says, I would set up one shepherd over them. One over them. He shall feed them, even my servant, David. But David is dead by this time. Should David come back and be king over Israel again? No. Who's the shepherd coming out of the lineage of David? Jesus Christ. Jesus is part of that lineage, that heritage. So he's talking about, he's prophesying, Ezekiel is, that I'm going to raise up Jesus to be that shepherd, that good pastor. But as you can see, Jesus is not being that good pastor, that shepherd of them, because of one problem, us. Not problem, but because of one entity, us, the church. If a Jew wants to get saved today, he has to come under the authority of, guess who? A Gentile. Because it's the church calling all the shots dealing with salvation. Woo! The body of believers. We're calling all the shots. We set the deal up under the authority of the Lord. He shows us how to set it up. We got it set up. So now, so they're going to have it, so okay. So, even my servant David, so when is this going to happen? At the millennium, the 1,000-year reign of Christ. He shall feed them, and he shall be their what? shepherd. He's going to be their pastor. What about the church? What about us? What role we play in that 1,000-year reign? Deal with that later. Talk to you about that later. Okay, now the Lord would be their what? Who's God?
Their God.
I'll be their God. And my servant David, a prince among them, obviously not David, the shepherd boy in the 23rd Psalm, he can't come back to life. Who would that be? That's going to be that root coming out of dry ground. Look in Isaiah 53, it describes that root. We did it last week. That root, not expected, a branch to come up out of a dusty, dry place. Who is that? What is that?
Isaiah 40:11 says, he shall feed his flock like a shepherd. He shall gather the lambs with his arms and carry them in his bosom. He shall gently lead those that are with young.
Yeah, so this is what this shepherd's going to do. All right, so this is, and he says, I, the Lord, at the end of verse 24, I, the Lord, have spoken it. You can count on it. It's going to happen. And I will make with them a covenant of what?
Peace.
Now, many people think peace is just no more war. That'd be good. Israel will appreciate that. But peace means take it back to where Adam was in the garden. That's the peace that God wants mankind to experience. Boy, Adam had it made. All he had to do was just be good to eat, lay up there and eat. You hungry, Adam? Yeah? Well, just walk over here to the potato patch. You hungry, Adam? Just walk over here to the green bean patch. Before Adam sinned, how much garden work did he have to do? But after Adam sinned, if you want to eat Adam, guess how you're going to get it? Sweat of your property. While he was with God, he was loving God, he was in righteousness, he was doing good. All he had to do was just wake up every morning. And the blessings of God was all over. After he said, now you got to make it by the sweat of the brow. You got to sweat it out. Wow. So the peace that he's going to bring in that millennium reign is going to be just like it was in the Garden of Eden. From the reestablished from the Lord's laws. Y'all with me?
Yeah.
Should we go get coffee and Krispy Kreme? Okay. I will make with them a covenant of peace, and will cause the evil beast to cease out of the land. The evil beast to get out of the land. Because right now in the land, the animal kingdom, you cannot trust it like Adam did back when he was in the garden. He could lie down with him. But now you go next to the wrong, go next to, I read the other day where a pit bull killed his owner. Get right next to the wrong animal, he'll eat you alive. It wasn't designed that way. That's not how God made this planet. He made this earth. Okay, look at Isaiah 11:6. Even back there by Jeremiah. Now that we're here, okay, we're there in chapter 11 of Isaiah.
Yeah.
I'm going to read verse 1 while you turn there. And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse. That's showing the lineage. And a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. The Spirit of wisdom, understanding, the Spirit of counsel, might, the Spirit of knowledge, and the fear of the Lord. That's nobody but Jesus. Verse 3, and should make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord. He should not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears, but with righteousness should he judge the poor, and reprove with fairness for the meek of the earth, he should smite the earth with the rod of his mouth. And we talked about going to verse 6. The wolf also shall dwell with the who?
The lamb.
With the lamb. And the leopard should lie down with the who? The kid goat, or whatever that is. And the calf and the young lion and the fatling together, and a little child should do what?
Lead
him. I wouldn't put my kid next to a pit bull on and go with China. Because animal kingdom, we can't trust them. Brother Al, will you go back to my backyard right now? I say, it's okay. It's okay, I'm going back there. He knows about 100-plus-pound German Shepherd back there that don't like nobody who needs. He knows. He was like, oh, I don't know. And I wouldn't trust my grandkids around. But I guess, well, no. Never, ever, as long as you live. Because animal kingdom, they just don't know. So here he's saying that we've got to restore that order of peace. All right. Praise God. And look at verse 8 and verse 9. Can't if you would somewhere.
Isaiah 11.
Uh-huh.
And the suckling child shall play on the hole of the ass.
Oh, that's snake, right?
Yes.
The hole of the snake.
And the weaned child shall put his hand on the cockatrice's den. Mm-hmm.
What is a cockatrice?
What? Right. Adder. Okay.
Viper.
Yeah.
Something.
They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea.
Woo, what a place to be. The peace of God's going to be all over the earth, just like the waters cover the sea. Ain't going to be all this crazy.
Verse 10 talks about that root of Jesse again.
Okay. And in that day there should be a root of Jesse, which shall stand for a sign of the people. It shall be, to it shall the Gentiles do what?
See.
And the rest, and his rest should be glorious. See, after that day, when the millennium kingdom gets set up, then the Gentiles is going to be trying to figure out, how do you get saved? That's what they're going to be asking, the Jews. How do you get saved? They're going to be talking to the Jews. Right now, the Jews got to ask us, what about this salvation now? How do you say a guy get everlasting life? As Nicodemus asked Jesus, how do I get born? How does a man get born again? Explain that to me. Explain that to me, Sister Pearl. How does a man get born again? I'm a scholar. Religious scholar. Do I go back into my mother's womb? How is that? So now the Jews ask the Gentiles, but in that day, the Gentiles would be asking. Because church is being over, you know, church. They don't believe that. Yeah, no church. Church on business, close. All right, verse 26. How about this?
How about this one?
Okay, and I will make them and the places around about my heel a blessing. I will cause the shower to come down in his season. There should be showers of blessing. One of the problems that we have there today, one of the big debates is global warming. Global warming. We got that one. It's a big deal going on now. Who's causing it? Is it really in effect? This past summer, man, I'm about to buy in. 117 degrees, 112 degrees. Man, it's hot. It's unusual. Last winter, I never put on a pair of gloves. They're still sitting up there on the shelf. I didn't put my hand in a pair of gloves last winter. Barely wore a coat. What's going on? Jesus says, in the times you'll see the signs coming in. Stuff is getting kind of wacky, out of order. Now, famines, no water, not enough rain right now. But he says in that day, be plenty of rain. Plenty of vegetation, plenty of food, no food shortages, none of that. Be plenty, plenty. Showers all the time, good showers at the right time, food growing at the right time. Oh, everybody's got that going on. Because that's how God's intention was for mankind. All right. And there, and the tree, verse 27, of the field shall yield her fruit, and the earth shall yield her increase, and they shall be safe in their land, and shall know that I am the Lord when I have broken what? The bands of their yoke, and delivered them out of the hand of those that serve themselves for them. The people that are taking advantage, I'm going to deliver them. This is the Jewish people now. And their land, Israel, Jerusalem, whatever you call it, is not a stable place. A lot of people want to go over there for a vacation. I counsel you otherwise. Go to the Bahamas or something like that, Mexico, Florida. But you might get blown up any moment over there in Israel. Throwing up buses, throwing stuff at you all the time. They don't care. It's a bad land. So, look at Acts, the third chapter, verse 19, 21. That's the activity chapter. You want to know what you should do as a Christian? Let's read the Acts. Acts 3rd chapter, verse 19. All right. What did he say? Go ahead, Sister Candy, 19 through 21.
Repent ye therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. Mm-hmm. And he shall send Jesus Christ, which before was preached unto you, whom the heaven must receive into the times of his restitution of all things, which God has spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began.
Yeah, since the world, God has been talking about, we want to restore it, we want to get it back. If we can just envision what Eden was like, we can just imagine what was Eden like, plenty of everything. There was no rain coming down from the sky. The ground gave its own rain. The thunderstorms, somebody heard it last night, the thunderstorms and all this stuff, the flood and too much water and all the stuff out of control, came after Adam's sin. Now here's the results of your sin. Life's upside down. Unpredictable. The tree might grow, the tree might not grow. The farmer might plant a good crop this year, he might not get a good crop. Might be too much sun come up. Might be too much water. You might not get enough to eat this year. Why? Because it's all in the hands of Satan. Adam turned it upside down. Satan took it, so he's running with it any way he wants to, and he's kicking God's people around any way he wants. And Israel said, something that can't count on me. So God is telling them that repent. He says, repent, be converted, your sins blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. He'll refresh it. He'll send Jesus, which was preached to you. You rejected him. The heaven must receive until the times of what? Restoration. Restore all things. Things is upside down right now. Some place, you know, you just don't know. All right. Praise God. So, verse 28. And there shall no more be a prey, and you shall be, no more of our lesson, no more be a prey to the who?
Heathen.
All right, no more pray to the heathen. Neither shall the beasts of the field, beasts of the land devour them, but they shall dwell safely, and none shall make them afraid. Isaiah 45 and 14, dwell safely. If you can get to your Bibles there, we'll look at it right quick. Turn to mine. Isaiah, right after the Psalms. 45:14. Okay. Thus said the Lord, the labor of Egypt and merchandise of Ethiopia and the Sabaeans, men of stature, should come over unto thee, and they should be thine. They should come over, they should come after thee, in chains that should come over, and they should fall down to thee. They should make supplication unto thee, saying, surely God is in thee, and there is none else. There is no God. In other words, the only place we're going to get good business is come dealing with you, exchange with you. All right, and I will raise up for them a plant of renown, but shall be no more consumed with hunger in the land, neither shall the shame of the heathen anymore. So, no more hunger, you won't be the
That's the lesson, verse 29.
That's the lesson, I'm sorry. Okay. Verse 30 of the lesson. Thus shall they know that I, the Lord their God, am with them, and that they, even the house of Israel, are who?
My
people. That's how they're going to know it. It's going to take a war. It's going to take almost total annihilation for them to come to the realization that Jesus is their Lord, because he's going to rescue them in this Armageddon mess on the earth. The church has been already lifted out before then. The church is lifted out. After the church is lifted out of here, this entity that the prophets of old did not see, there's this church, body of people getting out of here called the rapture. Then the millennium comes in after a time, and they're going to be able to say this: we know who our God is. We went through hell to find out who he is. But we got him now. This is Jesus the Messiah. We got him now. Okay, and then, even the house of Israel are my people, said the Lord God. So even the house of Israel, see, this is what I'm telling you right now, the nation of Israel, the Jews on the earth, Hebrew people across the globe, reject Jesus as Savior out of here. Amen. There is some Jews who do accept him as Savior, but they're in a very tiny, tiny, tiny bunch.
Called
traitor to the people. So he says, you are my flock. The flock of what?
My pastor.
The flock of my pastor are who?
Men.
Okay, define men.
Men.
Adam is what?
Men.
Men. See, the Lord wants to work with men on the earth. And this one, he says, you are. The people that I work with are men. Sometimes you think God is happy with working with angels and all of the heavenly hosts. He's not. That doesn't satisfy him. He wants fellowship and work with men. Guess where he want to work with men? This part of God. Where does God want to work with men? Fellowship with men. In heaven? On the earth. The people that walk around the earth and have no fellowship, no conscience, no sense of God's being is missing out on the reason why they were created. I got saved when I was 23, and I had no fellowship, no nothing with God. Pretty miserable time the first 23 years. Pretty miserable. I thought I was having fun, partying, all the paraphernalia and all that. I was really good. But man on the earth is missing out for his total reason for existing if he has no relationship with his maker. And what separates man from his maker is sin. And he's just lost his life. It's like, and you know, everything used to grow pretty good around here. Well, kapam, slam, bam, what is that? Diving for cover. What is that? He's scared now. Scared of his God. What's going on? Where he used to just wake up and give you a little moisture, mist on earth, feeding all the vegetation, everything's good. Get ready to eat, just go over there and get something. Life is nice. But sin turned things upside down, and he don't. Man does not know how to respond to his God. He's existing without a God on the earth, and he's just messing. So, you are my flock, the flock of my pastor. That millennium reign is going to, he's going to be dealing with men. I am your God, said the Lord. I am your God, said the Lord. So that God, he's going to, millennium reign is going to be something. The only thing that's keeping it from happening is the Gentiles are not getting saved. What's holding back the end of the end of time. What's slowing down the end times from getting here? The message is not getting to the Gentiles fast enough. Not the upside or the downside. The downside is that Gentiles going around killing themselves. I'll kill his kid. Yeah, 21, 22 years old. Boom, I kill him. Don't have no problems with him. Another kid over there kill me because I killed his kid. It's just going on. Nobody knows who their God. That's what happens when the gospel is delayed. Guy in the Empire State Building the other day. The gospel is delayed. This is what's happening. That's the downside to the gospel being delayed. Okay. We got to get out of here. God bless you.